Welcome to Ring of Fire. I'm Mike Papantonio. Coming up on today's show, we'll tell you why the Roberts Court is the most corrupt Supreme Court in American history. There's no other way to describe it. We'll explain how Wall Street's able to gamble away your savings without any fear of losing profits for themselves, even when they lose their clients' money. And we'll tell you why Social Security still isn't safe from the austerity nuts in Washington or from Wall Street. We have all that and more coming up, but right now, remember, you just stepped into the Ring of Fire.
You can't change Washington from the inside. You can only change it from the outside.
Grand jury secrecy rules.
For political gain.
The press can find out.
That has nothing to do with politics, but go ahead.
It wouldn't bother me.
Oops.
The recent Supreme Court decision of McCutcheon, it removes any doubt about this court majority, this very conservative court majority. If it comes down to a corporation versus anybody else, the corporation will always win to the tune of about 93% of the time. It's an ugly development in American in the American legal system. Unfortunately, there's very little we can do about it until there's a shift in this court. I have Joe Cotchett with me to talk about that. Joe, McCutcheon didn't leave us any doubt about the nature of this Supreme Court. That ruling, of course, just painted another picture about how if it's a corporate issue, if a corporation is at risk, the Supreme Court will always be there for that corporation. But people look at this in a different way. They're not looking at McCutcheon properly, are they?
Well, first of all, when you say the Supreme Court, we have to identify what we're talking about of the Supreme Court. Because what you really have is you have five people that are interested in economic ideology versus a real constitutional analysis. So let's not talk about the court in a general term. Let's talk about the fact that you right now have five people in majority. Remember, elected a president, Gore v. Bush. Five people in a majority that look at the economic ideology versus what is really constitutionally beneficial. So, talking about the McCutcheon case that just came down, I call that Citizens United 2. Citizens United, you know what that did, opened it up for people to give unlimited sums to their own personal PACs, if you want to call it that, to give out. Now along comes McCutcheon, which is Citizens United 2, which now allows any wealthy person to contribute up to the maximum of each candidate throughout the United States, that is to say, throughout Congress and Senate. Now, I predict to you here today, on April 14th, 2014, that we're going to see Citizens United 3, the trilogy, come along very soon, sooner than you know, because they're working their way up there, and that is to get rid of all limits. Because the mentality right now of the five who believe in an economic ideology believe, they go on this word freer, that money is free speech. Money is free speech. And if you put more money into the system, you develop freer speech.
So if money is free speech, then the people with the most money have more speech. I mean, that
that's taking it down.
Okay, well, but look, Joe, this is not, and yes, we're not talking about the entire court. We're talking about Alito. We're talking about Thomas. We're talking about Scalia. We're talking about Kennedy. It's apparent that this is a and Roberts, of course, this is a majority that came to this court with an agenda. I always like to explain it this way. We have a hard time looking at them as ideologue politicians because they have a black robe on. But truth be told, they're nothing more or less than a politician with a black robe. You had Roberts showed up during his hearings. Remember that?
He said,
I'm all about humility. I'm all about modesty. I'm all about restraint. I'm all about deference. And we're simply here just to call strikes and balls. What a tremendous lie that was. And he knew he was lying to the American public when he said those words. We've seen it to be a lie, haven't we?
Well, let me put it this way. You use the word lie. I don't call it a lie. I think he was right up front with what he meant. It's just that what we didn't do was peel back the skin deep enough to realize where Roberts was coming from. he goes back, I bring him back to economic ideology. For example, let's take a look at the Affordable Care Act, where he voted 5-4 in favor of upholding it. But let's now peel back the onion, if you will, and look at some of the reasons for that. Some of the reasons for that were really very simple. There were many out there in this country, big business, that were in favor of the Affordable Care Act because what it would mean is money in their pocket. So there was a real opportunity here. What Roberts is a strategist. There was a wonderful opportunity for some big businesses to make unbelievable money and tax benefits, putting people they didn't want to insure into pools. So he had an opportunity to be a phenomenal strategist. Now, his other four contemporaries that he usually votes with, Scalia, who I call sometimes, and other people call him Bill O'Reilly with a robe on, they make their positions absolutely clear. Roberts is careful enough to strategize how to use his vote.
Okay, Joe, two things. First of all, I went back and looked at the hearings for Roberts. Roberts was not honest. Roberts, they asked him, are you somebody who's aggressively going to try to change the law in favor of anybody, in favor of any side? Are you going to be an activist judge? Are you going to do something for corporate America? Are you going to do something for middle America? He says, I'm just going to follow the law. He has done everything but that since he has been, I call it in office, because he really is a politician with a robe. But I mean, I think the thing that's so disturbing about Roberts is, as you read that testimony that he gave before Congress, he absolutely knew that he was there because of corporate America. He was there at the behest of corporate America. He was there to deliver for corporate America, and that's all I've seen out of this guy. And this is the chief judge of this court.
You remember something interesting about Roberts. He was nominated for Sandra Day O'Connor's spot and then lobbied when Rehnquist died, then lobbied quickly by a lot of people, George W. Bush, to move him over into the chief spot. So in the sense, you're absolutely right, because the lobbyists that went to the White House to move him from the nomination of Sandra Day O'Connor's spot to the chief spot were corporate America. So in that sense, you're absolutely right. He came to us with an agenda. I think we all have agendas. The only issue is how we use them.
Well, Joe, with this, here we have, you gave a great example of the mainstream media not really even understanding what happened with Roberts on the ACA decision. Now let me back up just a little bit, because you said it. You said it quickly, but this is a very important point. He came out of the Obamacare ACA decision, and liberals were going, oh, my God, you know, this guy's great. Look at what he did for us. He knew exactly what to give away. In other words, here's what I'm saying. He knew that this decision that he made as far as ACA would not be a detraction. Well, it wouldn't vary his opinion in trying to protect corporate America. He knew corporate America really didn't care. It was almost an even split. But then you had the average progressive out there. You're saying, oh, my gosh, maybe he's changing. There's nothing changing about
there
this guy.
Nothing changes about him at all. As a matter of fact, we all know that the Heritage Foundation, several years ago, I'm not sure when it was, came out with a program for similar to the Affordable Care Act. Remember that Mitch Romney up in Massachusetts put in place the same type thing. So you're absolutely right. A great number of corporate executives in this country were all in favor of the Affordable Care Act. If they could dump some of the patients that they were insuring into a larger government pool and let everybody pay for it, how is that not good for that insurance company?
Yeah, and Joe, they progressives sometimes talk like it's a confounding development of Roberts, but really all it was another giveaway to corporate America. And that brings me back to the point. if you look at this majority, it's always about corporate America. Talk about Scalia. Here, look at Scalia on the Hobby Lobby, okay? Day one with Scalia, he has one position. Day two, when it's going to benefit corporate America, it's a different position. Do you see that same analogy?
It's not even a question. That's a good case, Hobby Lobby, because we think we don't know yet what the decision is, but we think we know where they're going to go. They're going to come down on the side of the employer. Because what it's all about is coming down on a contract theory, and that's the mentality of the five who are in majority, that corporate America has a right to operate under contracts with their employees. You remember the Smith case that was decided, where he voted for the employer's right to fire people if they use some form of marijuana called peyote or whatever it was called. He came down on the employer's side on that. Now, in Hobby Lobby, I think he's going to vote religious freedom of the employer, not the employee, that they have a right not to prescribe or go along with a program that will allow birth control.
He tried to dress up the Smith opinion on the peyote. This is where this really gets ugly. People listening to this program, pay attention to this. This is very important. These judges are smart enough to dress up what they're really after. So Scalia, on the peyote case, tried to dress it up and try to make it sound like it was a religious right issue. It wasn't a religious right issue. It was a corporate right issue. In the Hobby Lobby case, it's not going to be a religious, a constitutional religious issue. It's going to be, what does corporate America want? Look, I'm talking, Joe, and everybody who watches this program realize you have handled the most cutting-edge cases in this country against corporate America. I can tell you this. I know it, even though whether you admit it or not, I know it for a fact. It is always Joe against corporations. Now, the way this lands with this court, your chances of prevailing in front of this Supreme Court, because they're so heavily in love with corporations, have diminished by what percentage, would you say?
Well, I know this. I know on most of the cases we're handling, I couldn't get five votes. I will get four, but I will never get any member of that majority. And the rare instance I might get a Kennedy, that is a rare instance. We all know where Roberts is coming from. We've discussed that. I'm just not, in today's society, the way the structure of this court is, we are not going to get away from the influence of Wall Street and corporate America.
And we're going to see discrimination cases against women. They're always going to lose against a corporation. You're going to see right to work issues. The worker's always going to lose. You're going to see class actions where workers and women are at risk. Corporations going to win. Women and workers are going to lose. It is so predictable that, as a matter of fact, last time this was looked at, the range was anywhere between 87% and 93%. The times that corporate America always wins with this court. It's a staggering time. We haven't seen it since the 1930s. All we can count on is time to change that. Joe, thanks for being out there, okay? You are always fighting the fight, the good fight for workers against this corporate America that we're talking about right here. Thanks for joining me.
Thank you, Mike, very much.
Typically, when Wall Street loses someone's money, they also lose their profit. But that's not the case nowadays. Banks can lose what they want. They can engage in damn near criminal activity, knowing that taxpayers are going to bail them out when they get caught. I have Mike Burg with me to talk about that. Mike, the SEC now found colluding with the big banks, colluding with Wall Street. Report came out two reports in the last couple of weeks talking about collusion between the SEC and how Wall Street bankers never lose. Now we see this story that came out from David Dayan, Salon.com, incredible story that actually traces how Wall Street has subsidy safety nets, because the banks have gotten so big that government is always there to bail them out. Talk about that subsidy.
Well, you know, it started obviously with the Bush administration bailing out the giant mega banks, and it's continued on. What's amazing about it is that these big banks are allowed to borrow at rates that are less than what other banks can borrow at. gives them a competitive advantage, and it forces them to be in a position where they're getting cheap money, they're not getting it to the public, and what they're doing is going back right to the trough where they were before on very risky securitized products, just like we had in 2007, 2008 with the collapse of the economy. And it's because they know they're going to be bailed out by our government and even the IMF.
Okay, so what you have is anybody lending money to big banks says, you know, they can be as risky as they want. They can engage in CDOs and toxic trash like synthetics, swaps, you name it. They can do it because they can be incompetent. They can be liars. They can be cheats. They can steal from us. They can get caught, and still the government is going to be there to bail them out. Now, add to that, Mike, the fact that the SEC is so lame that now we're seeing these reports that the SEC is actually colluding with them. It's completely a win-win situation for the big banks in Wall Street. I don't know how else to see it.
Well, Mike, let me tell you, we've been talking about this for years. I have a major case that's in the state of Connecticut in which our judge was removed. And let me just tell you, because we haven't talked about this, for suing one of the big banks, one of the huge banks, UBS, there was an SEC investigation of my client who hadn't done anything. You talk about collusion. And it went on and on and on and on until that judge who gave us a great ruling was removed. And then the SEC dropped their investigation of my client, who had done nothing wrong.
Okay, let me back up on that. Here, your client was stolen from to the tune of hundreds of millions of dollars.
Correct, over $100 million.
UBS steals from your client to the tune of hundreds of millions of dollars. Rather than saying, well, shouldn't we look at what UBS did? The SEC says, no, we're going to target the poor guy who's bringing the case against UBS. And then the end of the story, if I get it right, is the judge is then removed? Tell us how that happened.
Well, what happened is we had a judge gave us a great order, made them post over a $50 million bond. The judge got removed in the middle of the case, was sent to domestic relations, which we all know that's where judges, the last place they want to be. We had a new judge who has done nothing but sit on the case for 3 years. We've gotten nowhere while my client was targeted. We gave information to the SEC about UBS and Moody's, and the target becomes my client. This is just unbelievable.
Is there any question that the removal of the judge that was saying to UBS, you know what, you need to give it up, you need to give us information, you need to expose documents that you've been hiding, you need to give depositions. Is there any question in your mind, Mike, that judge was removed because he was hot on UBS's trail and this new judge is there to make this case disappear?
In my opinion, there is no question it is related. Not only that, but Williams and Connolly, who we know, they're the lawyers who represent UBS, and they're the ones who were on this case. Quite frankly, what's amazing to me is these large banks under these circumstances have paid the government money, but none of that money has gotten to the people who actually were stolen, where the money was stolen from.
Okay, let me back up on this. We start off with a position to where a big bank, a Goldman Sachs, any of these folks, they can take all the risks they want. You know, they can push the limits on decency. They can, as I say, lie, cheat, and steal. And the people who loan them money say, well, that's okay. If they get caught, if they fail, if their incompetence surfaces again, U.S. taxpayers are going to bail them out. But mom and pop bank right down the street, maybe they're not right there in Wall Street. They're in middle America. They try to get the same kind of money. And what they're worried about is that I don't want to loan them money because the FDIC may come in and find something wrong and nobody's going to bail these people out. I saw an estimate, Mike, on what this is almost a $50 billion a year, almost a $50 billion a year subsidy that taxpayers are paying because of this scam going on.
Well, and worldwide, Mike, the figures I saw from the IMF, which most people don't realize how powerful the IMF is, the International Monetary Fund. And what they say is these banks are too important to fail. Not too big, but too important. And the subsidy worldwide is over $590 billion.
Mm, mm. Okay, so $590 billion is what these creeps, I mean, these banks that understand, look, they are the cowboys. They're going to just take whatever kind of risk they want because whether you're in the United States, whether you're in Europe, they're going to get bailed out because part of their plan has been to get bigger. Now, let me ask you something. We're out here thinking that the Dodd-Frank change made a difference, that Dodd-Frank has a huge impact, and now we're not going to let these thieves, I mean the biggest thieves of the biggest thieves, we're not going to let them get any bigger because if we do, we're going to have another crash just like the one we saw. Give me your take on Dodd-Frank.
Dodd-Frank was a good idea, but the implementation of it and the provisions that were put in do nothing to stop these mega banks from doing what they're doing. And it's interesting, when you see the prosecution under Dodd-Frank, it's not against the large banks. It's against the little guy. It's been the smaller companies. What they want to do, if you see any enforcement going on right now by the SEC, by Justice, it's not against these people. It's against the small guy. And that's where they're going to use the provisions. But against the mega banks, It's not doing anything.
Mike, or what you're seeing, and that's an interesting, I mean, you do this all the time. You're confronting these huge, huge organizations, these bank and Wall Street organizations all the time. Isn't the pattern that we're seeing from this Obama administration, from Eric Holder and everybody who works for Obama, aren't we really seeing that what we're going to do is we're going to give the impression to the American public that Obama's doing something, that Eric Holder's doing something, because we're going to hit him with these big fines. And then when they want to make a big splash and make it look like we're having a perp walk, what they do is they go after these smaller banks, almost no count where it comes to comparing that bank to Wall Street. Isn't that kind of the PR scene that we've seen Obama play out from the very first day that he promised he was going to do something about this? Isn't this the scene we've seen playing out?
Exactly. What they're doing, Mike, is unbelievable, and the audience should know what they're doing. First of all, these big fines, these are money that the government gave them. Then they used that money, didn't give loans, made money on it, continued to make money on it, built it up, paid back the taxpayer. This is sort of the payback of our own money, the $1 billion fines or $2 billion fines that we're reading about. And then the prosecution part. You know, if anybody did half what these giant banks did, those people are going to jail.
Mike, in some parts of the world, you have what they call the death penalty for banks or death penalty for a corporation. For example, when we saw, you know, the biggest banks in the world that we caught, I mean, there wasn't any question. They had to admit that they were laundering money for drug cartels, laundering money for terrorists, and making huge profits. When we caught those banks doing that, they nothing came of it. There have been no prosecutions. There probably will be no prosecutions. But that bank pays their way out of it. When we have a bank, say in some middle America, where they're just the FDIC says, well, you know, we don't really like the way that you're accounting for some of this money. We think you're overly risky because you're actually loaning money. God forbid banks should loan money, but you're loaning money and we think you're being a little risky. We've seen situations that are just, when you look at the facts, are incredible. They shut them down. The SEC comes in, FDIC comes in, and they say, hey, you know, this is not the way we do business.
Not only do they shut them down, we have a bank here in Colorado, a fairly small bank, that basically its capital requirements weren't met. Their main claim that they shut down the bank. And then they're going after all the directors and the officers on criminal charges, as opposed to the criminal charges that should have been filed against these large mega banks that cost the world economy through crooked dealings almost $7.5 trillion.
Yeah, latest story, Bank of America, they got to pay another $600 million. $600 million means nothing to Bank of America. We see it constantly. I don't think you, almost every month, it's almost gotten every 2 weeks, you pick up a story where there's some huge fine. Now, what we do know is that Eric Holder has gotten his marching orders all the way from the top. We're moving into an election. You have Hillary Clinton that's the front runner. Wall Street loves Hillary Clinton because Bill Clinton gave Wall Street everything they wanted. Bill Clinton is the one that let Glass-Steagall lapse and just become meaningless law, did away with Glass-Steagall. Bill Clinton is the one that gave Wall Street NAFTA. Bill Clinton is the one that gave Wall Street CAFTA. Bill Clinton is the one that has let Wall Street get away with damn near everything they've wanted. And now they see Hillary coming along and Obama, by Democratic influence, has been told, don't mess with the banks now because Hillary's going to need that money. Isn't that kind of what's happening here?
You know what? It certainly is likely that that's what's happening. I hope at the bottom of my heart that Hillary Clinton is going to walk away from all that. But absolutely, if you look at history, Glass-Steagall was the beginning of all this happening, and it's gone crazy. It's out of control. And the everyday people are the ones who are getting hurt. The small guy, the small banks, the competitive advantage that they've been given, the ability to do investments, it's out of control and it's dangerous.
Michael, my prediction is that Hillary Clinton will simply be an extension of all that. I'd like to think different. We need to rethink who that Democratic presidential candidate is. Mike Burg, thank you for joining me, okay?
Thank you, Mike.
The mainstream media has stopped talking about Social Security cuts that are taking place. Both parties are responsible for those cuts. The goal is to make Social Security look dysfunctional so Wall Street can get all that money and lose it in the market. That's really the headlines of this story. Joining me now to talk about that is Richard Eskow. He's host of the show The Breakdown. Richard, you know, Wall Street has wanted possession of Social Security since day one. They just never stop fighting, do they? What's their new approach to taking care of the idea, well, ensuring that they get mom and pop's money and be able to squander it like they did last time in the last burn down?
Well, I wouldn't call it so much of a new approach as I would a kind of covert approach that says that we're going to starve the program of administrative funding, we're going to close the field offices, we're going to make it hard to get through on the telephone, and that's going to convince everybody that, you see, we told you government doesn't work, government isn't efficient, when in fact it's a very efficient program. But once they take all the funding away, you can't get through on the phone, you can't get to a field office, then they get to come in and say, you know what, Wall Street can do this job a lot better for you.
Let's go ahead and let's get a standing of where Social Security offices, the administrative process is now. People out there in middle America, they're feeling this. Disabled people are feeling it because they can't get care, and elderly are feeling it. Children, poverty-stricken children are feeling it. But what's the methodology for bringing all of this dysfunction together? What are the steps? What are we seeing?
Well, first of all, the first step is, even though this is a self-funded program, including the offices and the administration, the first step is to throw the cost of Social Security in with all the budget talk and all the austerity madness out there. Cut the administrative budget. It's gone down from 0.1% 30 years ago to less than 1% now, and then start closing all the field offices you can and tell everybody, well, the future is the internet anyway, so just come to us on the internet. So that's what they've been doing now. They've been
tell us about the field offices. How day to day, how is the field office used by the elderly or the disabled that are counting on Social Security just to be able to eat? How's that field office used?
Well, first of all, you go there to get proof of enrollment. You can go there to enroll in the program. You can go there if you're disabled. Now, this is a big one, because if you're disabled, these field offices are the best place to go to appeal any negative decision if you get turned down or whatever. Right now, already, even before the next round of cuts takes place, it takes more than a year on average for a disability appeal to get heard. And in the meantime, that disabled person is not getting a check. So that's going to hurt those people quite a bit. The other people who are hurt are low-income people who have to apply for food assistance, because they go to these field offices in order to get the paper. And if they can't get it, you know, they're not likely to be on the internet with a laser printer and all of that either. So it's hurting people in each of these ways.
Richard, they're told that, gee whiz, if you this is really where the conservative Republicans are headed. And by the way, some Democrats, too. Let's just be honest about this. It's not just all Republican, primarily Republican, primarily Wall Street Republicans. But we now have Wall Street Democrats that would love to see this happen, too, because it empowers Wall Street even more. We saw the 401k argument. You know, remember that 401k, if you let us have your 401k money because the system is broken, 401k is going to do better. That simply is not true when you look at the numbers at all, is it?
No, not true at all. It costs a lot more to manage one of these programs through Wall Street than it does to manage it through the government. Just the money handling charge alone for a 401k program can cost between $76,000 and $100,000 of a person's lifetime savings. It's 2.5% sometimes just for the money handling charge, whereas the total cost of Social Security is less than 1%.
Okay, so but this is where Wall Street is going. Wall Street is going, give us your money. Government is stupid. Government's dysfunctional. Just look, you don't have any field offices. You can't get a telephone call answered. You don't have any direction. But the rest of that story is Wall Street are the very people that have their thuggish-like congressmen and their thuggish senators going forward and making sure that field offices are closed, making sure that nobody answers the telephone, making sure that there's a cut down in staff to where the program doesn't run, and because they want another 401k, don't they?
They sure do. They want another 401k. They tried to take over this program directly under President Bush. It was so unpopular they had to back off. So they're going to do it through these underhanded means, and that's what they're doing here, so that they can get their hands on as much of this money as they can. This is another example, like Medicare, where the government is actually running a program more efficiently from a cost point of view and a service point of view than the private sector can, but they don't want you to believe that, so they're cutting costs even more to the point of real pain for millions of people so that they can get what they want.
Your article on the invisible Social Security cuts, and it's invisible because the media doesn't report it. Again, it's the damn brain dead media that doesn't report this. I mean, that's the problem. But you did report it, and you said that 62, that nationwide staff is down to 62,000 from 70,000, that they've cut 92 field offices, that they've closed 521 contact stations. I mean, just on and on. How is and by the way, you remember, as you point out, you used to get a report from Social Security every year, and it would say, this is the value of your Social Security. What's happened with that?
Well, they stopped printing those too, and they made a big deal of the fact that they would save $70 million a year, which is nothing. You know, people depend on those to know where they stand. You know, Mike, I tried to go in myself and find out on the internet. It's just too hard the way they've set it up. And isn't that convenient? Because all those folks who want to cut the benefits, they're going to be pretty embarrassed if all of a sudden you get one of those statements and it shows a lower benefit than you were supposed to get as of last year. So it serves a dual purpose here, but really, it's just another way to keep people detached from their Social Security program. And if they have their way, you'll never see another printed statement again.
Richard, did I get it right that it's hardly recognizable any difference between the Wall Street Democrat and the Wall Street Republican on this issue? I mean, am I just reading too much into that, or is it both parties that are dead set on making Wall Street happy, on taking this huge amount of Social Security money, giving it to Wall Street, allowing Wall Street to lose it the same way they did in the last burndown? Is that it's both parties, isn't it?
Well, I'd like to call you wrong on that one, but so far I haven't seen too many Democrats stepping up and saying this is wrong. You know, they're all playing the same game, and the Wall Street Democrats are all for this. They think it's wonderful. They're also throwing in little private savings programs that'll eventually be run by Wall Street. So sure, you have people here and there who are speaking up against this, mostly when an office gets closed in their district. But by and large, the Democrats aren't fighting this any more than the Republicans are pushing it, and the Democrats are at best going along and sometimes pushing it also.
What's your reaction to this ridiculous talking point that, gee whiz, yeah, we're closing down 521 contact stations, we're closing down 92 field offices, we're you know, firing 10,000 Social Security administrative workers, but that's okay because you're going to be able to talk to us on the internet. Give us your reaction to that.
It's absolutely ridiculous. First of all, seniors use the internet much less than other people do, 57%, I think, as opposed to 80%. Secondly, you know, I'm pretty good on the internet. I couldn't sign up through their program. They make it too hard. They make you have to remember a P.O. box that you used for 3 months in 1999, and if you don't answer that question right, you're out for 24 hours, and then you try again a day later, and it asks you, you know, who co-signed your auto loan, and, you know, what auto insurance company. I don't remember these things. Imagine how I'll be at 80 at doing that.
Well,
it's ridiculous.
Well, isn't part of it they understand? I mean, they understand that as far as people over 65, you've got about 50% of them that are, you know, that even use the internet for anything. And then that number starts falling when you start saying, okay, do they use it for complex analysis? And is there any way, I mean, certainly less than 50% use it for complex analysis. And certainly this is complex analysis. When you get on that internet site and try to figure out what in the hell are they talking about? What do I do next? And people just give up, don't they?
They sure do. And by the way, those figures about who's on the internet, they don't count who has a printer. If you've got to print out a document and take it to the food stamp office or whatever, you know, so it's just ridiculous. It's way too complicated. It's not, in my opinion, it's not even meant to work. It's meant to break down.
Well, it's meant to create a customer disservice, as you put it. The customer disservice means, and then the customer typically doesn't have the insight to figure out how is all this happening. They don't keep up. Look, most of these customers are concerned, how am I going to eat today? How am I going to pay for my rent? They're not following the politics behind this. They're not following the both Republican and Democrat who are making these sweetheart deals. So Wall Street, in the end, can benefit here. So isn't part of this, you want to create a disservice to where people get mad at the system and say, hell, Social Security doesn't work anymore, right? I mean, isn't that where this is going?
Oh, you bet. You bet, you know, because they're always saying government doesn't work. And now people will be saying, oh, that's for sure. I couldn't find a field office and it took me 4 hours to get through on the phone. I guess government doesn't work. Let's give it to my bank. That's exactly what they're trying to do.
So where does this land? I mean, tell me, Richard, you write about political issues like this every day and have for years. Where does this one land?
Where does it land? You mean where does it come out? How does
it
come out?
Yes.
It comes out that the bad guys keep winning on this one unless people stand up and object and say, no, we don't accept these cuts. We take this as a cut to Social Security because it is. While you're waiting to collect your benefits, that's a cut. So we don't like these backdoor cuts. We want the service we paid for. When we paid into this program all our working lives, we were paying to have somebody there on the phone when we called. We were paying for a field office so that we could get what we need and we demand. If people don't stand up and fight, I don't see a happy ending for this.
Well, and the other part of the story to me, Richard, it seems that there's only the Richard Eskow people out there that understand issues like this that are reporting it. You don't see mainstream reporting this at all. You can't find a story on this with mainstream media. We try sometimes, okay? Richard Eskow, thank you for joining us, okay?
Good to be here. Thanks.
Drug industry's in trouble again, this time for hiding the dangers of a blood pressure medication that's destroying the intestines of its patients. The drug's called Benicar. Joining me now to talk about this latest blockbuster drug is Daniel Nigh. Daniel Nigh, another dangerous drugs. You are a go-to person for these stories. And every time I hear another one, I just go, when the hell is the FDA going to do their job? When is this administration going to make the FDA do their job? It all has to do with appointments, doesn't it? I mean, this president, this administration could appoint a person to make sure the kind of thing that we're about to talk about doesn't happen. So tell me this story. This is another outrageous story.
There's no doubt, Pap. I mean, every time what we see is revolving door, the FDA and the pharmaceutical company, we see the same people go from the pharmaceutical companies to the FDA and back. And so obviously, they've got the same purpose, and the same purpose is to get money for these manufacturing companies. Today, what we're seeing is we've got a company known as Daiichi Sankyo. It's a Japanese manufacturer that also has a U.S. entity here in the, or has a subdivision in the U.S. And what they have is they've got a drug called Benicar. And Benicar is causing in some folks who are taking the drug massive chronic diarrhea that they, some of these folks have suffered for years and had no idea that the drug was even causing it.
Well, just to be clear, we're not just talking about a drug that causes diarrhea. This causes death. I mean, this actually causes something that looks like a Crohn's disease. It causes something that it affects the entire body systemically, doesn't it?
That's right. And these folks who are going through this, they have no idea what the problem is. The doctors are in the emergency room. The doctors are treating for Crohn's disease. They're treating for celiac. They're treating for IBS. You know, everything under the sun, and they can't treat them oftentimes.
And what is this medicine? Why do people take the medicine?
Well, you know, actually, it's to treat high blood pressure. And so that's one of the other things as well, is that there are many other alternatives to treat high blood pressure, so that if somebody were notified, hey, this problem is causing chronic diarrhea, what's odd is that people could just stop taking the medicine and they would have been better. They oftentimes become better.
It's really more than that. It is a chronic dysfunction in the digestive system. I don't want people listening to this report and think, oh, well, it's just a matter of chronic diet. No, this is something that can shut down your digestive system permanently.
That's right.
And so what ends up happening is they go to the doctor, they have problem. The doctor clears it up. They come back home. They start taking Benicar again for high blood pressure when there are 50 other drugs they can take that don't cause these kinds of problems. And they go back into another chronic episode. Tell me about some of the cases you've seen. How bad are they?
Well, the other thing is, you know, this, having gone through years and years of this chronic diarrhea, you know, I've got clients who have 10 to 20 bowel movements a day, and they've gone through this for years. What happens is they have massive dehydration. They will drop 70 pounds in less than a year. And as a result of this, I've even have a couple of clients who I represent the families of the person who died in the hospital, in the ER, renal failure, liver failure, kidney failure, because the organs shut down after going through this for so long and suffering such dehydration and weight loss over a quick period of time or a long period of time that the organs will shut down. And that's
well,
the risk.
Well, it's something called a rebound effect, isn't it? In other words, the system is, you clear your system of it, you're in the hospital, the doctor doesn't know why you're there, the doctor thinks you have Crohn's disease, IBD, they think you have some type of very serious kind of intestinal issue, you get out, you think everything's fine, start taking the Benicar again, and nobody ever puts it together because there was no warning. Nobody told anybody because the damn FDA, again, didn't require that this company making Benicar, this Japanese company making a god-awful amount of money here in the United States selling this product, nobody required that they do in the United States what they have to warn about in other countries. Did I get that right?
That's absolutely right. This drug was released in 2002, and the FDA waited all the way until July of 2013 to finally require Daiichi Sankyo to put a warning on their label saying that these massive chronic diarrhea and dehydration can occur as a result of taking this product. It waited them 11 years. And only after the Mayo Clinic found this association did they finally adopt that warning label change.
Isn't part of the problem that the reintroduction of the Benicar after the problem may have cleared up episodically, the reintroduction actually gets to where it affects the stomach lining. It affects the intestinal walls. You have dehydration in the intestinal walls, and in fact, all of the organ systems. So what you're going to hear is you're going to hear Benicar say, oh, this is just a minor problem. No, it's not. It's a very serious problem that has resulted in death. It's resulted in long-term chronic illness from this. Am I overstating that at all, Daniel? Pick up with that idea.
No, absolutely not. Not overstating that at all. There are some clients who have just the worst of symptoms. Some have passed away. Some, they continue. You know, I've represented a client or two that feeds through a PEG tube. We've got multiple other clients who had, you know, multiple visits to the emergency room, 30, 40 emergency room visits or hospitalizations in the last 3 years. And as a result, these are folks who may have lost their job as a result of it. They may have had organs that have deterioration as a result of it. You know, the other thing is that they will treat because the doctors don't know what the problem is. they will give them all sorts of other medication trying to treat them for other diagnoses. And those other types of treatment can also cause them severe problems, such as taking steroids in large dosages.
This is a case that's in early development, but just looking at this, what's your call on how long this company has known about the dangers of Benicar and just simply hasn't told anybody?
It's really hard to tell, but the key is that they clearly must have known about it before the 2012 Mayo Clinic study. There's all sorts of reports to the FDA, reports to the manufacturer that show that they knew of some association between these two, that there's lots of clients who are suffering from chronic diarrhea and dehydration as a result of taking this product. So clearly they knew about it beforehand.
And their decision is, hey, we're making money. It'll be a long time before anybody really finds out about this. If we're making $1 billion a year, we can maybe we can sell this thing for 10 years. It may cost us $1 billion in the long run, but we're going to make a lot of profit in the process. That's kind of the way I see this Benicar case developing. Anyway, Daniel Nigh, thank you for joining me. Keep us posted on this. This is not a minor case at all. This is a very serious case. And unfortunately, the FDA has dropped the ball even once again. Thanks.
Thanks, Pat.
We have Richard Mack, the former sheriff of Graham County, Arizona. He made the comment that he has sources inside the federal government warning that the weekend retreat was only a move to distract attention, diffuse tensions, because a raid on the family's ranch is being planned. Couple that with Harry Reid's comments that this is not over. You've got to believe that something is brewing here, no? If he's saying it's not over, and then you have a sheriff saying he has sources inside the government, what would happen? God forbid. I mean, we saw the raid, for example, back with Elliot and Gonzalez. I'm not sure if you remember that raid. What would happen if they came in the early morning hours one day to your ranch?
Well, first I got to say, Harry, get your army out of Nevada. Get your army away from my ranch and off Clark County public land and keep it out. And if they come, we'll deal with them tonight. If that's what we got to do, we'll just deal with you.
And at the very end, he even asked Hannity, I mean, the most provocative question wasn't in that shot, where Hannity actually said, you know, to the son, will you defend your father if they come in the middle of the night? Joining me now for more on this and the latest in the Clive and Bundy saga is Mike Papantonio, America's lawyer and host of Ring of Fire Radio. Pap, welcome back.
Tom, how are you?
I'm fine. What's your take on what's going down in Nevada?
Well, I mean, you know, first of all, put it into perspective, this character that you just saw was mixed in a group of white supremacists, sovereign citizens, just about every oddball that you could have mixed into that group. Understand, this is the group. You had a former sheriff say, we put our women up first. We put our women in the front of the line with children, and they did that in hopes that a woman would get shot, and all of a sudden they could have this federal apocalyptic kind of a war that they've waited for so long. Most of the people in that group, Tom, they wouldn't know which end of a cow to feed. They were from all over the California. They were from Idaho. They didn't have any kinship with what was going on there. They were there to kill somebody. It's just like two or three of them said, I will pull the trigger and kill a federal agent if they open fire. They're itching to kill somebody. This is exactly what you see at the rise of any kind of fascist movement. You always have the least common denominator types out there that really would kill someone. And so this is not a minor story. You know, my disappointment here is that the mainstream media they're not able to connect the dots with what's going on here. They're not able to say, you know, it's not just an oddity of what we see here. You know, this is not just merely a Tim McVeigh kind of story, or this is not even just a Waco kind of story. This is a movement where you had people there that are dying to get into a war with the federal government, and quite frankly, the feds handled this properly because they can take everything this man has, make him a pauper, which they need to do. They can take every asset he has, freeze every asset, make his life as miserable as possible without firing a shot. And that's what Harry Reid's talking about when he says it's not over.
Yeah, so the next step, presumably, rather than, you know, they tried rounding up his cattle, and I understand if you just take the number of cattle he's got and multiply it by the, you know, what cattle are selling for at wholesale these days, beef on the hoof. He's got about $1.75 million worth of cattle there. So you're saying they can basically garnish his bank account the way you would a deadbeat dad?
Oh, they can close him down, Tom. This guy, if he sells a cow, the money's going to go to the federal government. They can freeze his assets, and they'll do it. Look, they have messed around with this guy for 20 years. Three court orders where federal judges have said, Mr. Bundy, can't we compromise? Can't we just work it out? It's not about working out. The guy is a lunatic. His followers are lunatics. There's nothing noble about it. He's not a patriot. He's a deadbeat. He's a moocher stealing from American taxpayers. The people watching this program, he has stolen more than $1 million from you. And he wants to feed his cattle for nothing. Who doesn't? Who would love to say, look, tax season is here. Who would love to say, gee whiz, you know, I really don't want to pay my taxes. The problem is this is much deeper than that little scene we saw taking place in Nevada. This goes all the way back to the beginning of the Sagebrush Rebellion, where you had a secret meeting that took place at the Golden Nugget Saloon, and you had the Coors family and the Scaife family and every billionaire in the country meeting together to figure out how they can undermine the U.S. government. That happened decades ago. The only thing they were lacking, Tom, and they figured this out, they were simply lacking the militia and the foot people to do it. You had billionaires without anybody to go out and act out their craziness. So now they have the foot soldiers. It's come full circle. You know, it's been decades now, but now the Sagebrush Rebellion continues, and this is an example of it right here.
Well, and in fact, Americans for Prosperity, one of the front groups for the Koch brothers, heavily funded by the Koch brothers, has been running. There's a video they have. I don't want to run the whole video. It's too long a clip. But they also have these, you know, made for Facebook pieces that they've been pushing out and tweeting out.
Yes.
That basically make it look like the whole thing is Harry Reid trying to do a land grab, and you know, some fairly professionally produced stuff. And you look at this and you go, why is Americans for Prosperity doing this? I went over to Koch Industries website, and they've got three ranches, the Koch Industries has, almost 500,000 acres. About half of that is apparently federal land in three different states. And I thought, you know, on the surface, maybe that has something to do with it. You know, they would like to not have to pay their grazing fees, too. But you're suggesting that this is really much deeper than that?
Oh, it's much deeper, Tom. Listen, these boneheads that showed up with their AK-47s and their 9mm there to kill somebody if they could, they don't have the money or the sophistication to put together the kind of ad campaign you're talking about. This originates with people like the Kochs. With the Kochs, it's not about cattle. With the Kochs, it is deregulate everything because we own everything now and we like to continue owning everything. We don't want regulations in the country. And so this is just another way to create this fight between America and the federal government. They hate the federal government. They don't want to pay taxes. They don't want regulations. They want to be able to continue to pollute our waters and streams. They don't want workers to have rights. How do you do that? You get rid of the government. And these boneheads that they had in Nevada are simply their tool. They don't even realize that they're a tool. They don't realize that the Koch brothers and the money behind this, they would not let them into the back door of their country club as servants. And they somehow feel a kinship with it. They feel this is a great, noble fight. They feel like they're patriots. They feel like they have some kinship with the founders of this country. Look, the founders of this country would put these people in prison, if not hang them, for treason.
This is more than the Whiskey Rebellion. I mean, this is... George Washington put down. We just have about 40 seconds here, Pap. Do you think it's a coincidence that about the time this thing started going really getting blown up on Fox News and Americans for Prosperity started pushing it out was just after Harry Reid started calling the Koch brothers out on the floor of the Senate?
It's completely connected. Look, Koch brothers are after Harry Reid because Harry Reid has enough guts to stand up to him. You know what he said to him? Come on. You want to fight? Come on. Let's see who wins that fight. A guy, and of course, they have the mouthpiece like Hannity, whose ratings are in the tank. His ratings are so bad, he has to do something to call attention to himself. To himself. And so they call on people like Hannity to keep it out there in the media. So this is all connected. I mean, these parts are easy to follow. Unfortunately, mainstream media doesn't have enough sense to put the parts together and tell the story in a way that Americans can see how dangerous this little event that took place out in Nevada really was.
And thank you for putting it together for us, Mike Papantonio. Great having you here with us, Pat.
That's it for this week's Ring of Fire, but you can keep up with us throughout the week online at ringoffireradio.com or at Twitter at Ring of Fire Radio and on Facebook. I'm Mike Papantonio. We'll see you next week right here on Ring of Fire.